you know, I wish that human courtship involved a beautiful dance like that. I think I would quite like it. I said beautiful, Chris. That is just weird. No, stop it. You're freaking me out.
I've tried regurgitation. I've tried dancing. What more can a man do?
Just nothing. Anyway, the good news is that Hattie, the female hen harrier, had 5 eggs and all the chicks hatched successfully, as you can see in the photo there. And that's brilliant news because up in Scotland, they reckon there's just over 500 hen harrier pairs. So those chicks will help to boost the numbers up in Scotland. And then Natural England plans to put satellite tags on this year's chicks. We hope to follow them and we'll bring you an update in Autumn Watch.
It's very important that we learn more about these rare birds because they are in trouble. They're a beautiful species and they should be breeding all over the UK. We seem to think of them now as a bird of moorland, but they could nest absolutely everywhere. When you see them flying around, they look stunning and they could be flying over the south of England. We've calculated that 300 pairs of them could be nesting in England. Last year, no young were raised by hen harriers at all. I can tell you at the moment there were 3 nests, some with young and some with eggs. So what's the problem here? Well, the problem is persecution of raptors. And sadly, it's not just hen harriers. Recently on the Black Isle in Scotland, no fewer than 22 birds of prey were illegally poisoned. They were red kites, birds like this. They were buzzards too. Now, we are taking this very seriously. The RSPB have currently got a £27,000 reward for any information that leads to a successful prosecution in this instance. But, you know, the other day, I was recounting a story. When I was a kid, I begged my dad to bring me here to see what I thought could be the last pair of marsh harriers breeding. And he drove all the way from Southampton to bring me up here to Minsmere to see them. What about if there's a young ornithologist sat on a sofa watching this programme who was about to beg their dad to drive them all the way to Scotland to see a hen harrier? I mean, look, Lineker, 1990 to Robson. It means think about it. And you can think about it and you can help, particularly when it comes to hen harriers, because the RSPB have got a hen harrier hotline. And what we'd like you to do is contact us via our website, bbc.co.uk/springwatch, and let us know if you see a hen harrier. By mapping these animals, we can monitor them. And if we can monitor them, then we might be able to look after them. And that young ornithologist might not need to be such a beggar towards his dad.
Do you know, Chris, I reckon we should have a hotline for Martin because he has spread himself around this area quite a lot during this series, hasn't he? So,
certainly has.
So maybe people could ring in if they spot the unique
or
and
we
the
can
rare,
satellite track him.
The one-off Martin Hughes-Games. We could satellite track him
Oh,
as well.
I don't really want to know where he goes all the time, though, to be quite honest. He's got some strange habits.
Now, let's have another look round this heathland. OK, we've seen that it's very good for reptiles and there's quite a few very rare birds that it's managed for. We've also seen something much bigger, one of the biggest creatures you get on all the reserves here, red deer. It's an interesting time of year for the red deer. These young stags are growing their antlers. They shed them in winter and now they have to grow them from scratch again. And you can see that very soft-looking velvet, they call it, surrounding the antlers, and that's very vascular, and that provides the blood and the nutrients to grow the antlers. It's the fastest growing tissue of any mammalian, any mammal at all. They can grow up to 1 inch a day. So they're all about, and it's fascinating to think that those stags, they're eating very peacefully together at the moment, but when the rut comes in autumn, they'll be mortal enemies and they'll be at each one another. Of course, we've also had our cameras up here looking during the night, and that's when it gets really interesting. Because in nighttime, all sorts of secrets are revealed. Now, we knew that the deer would be calving, but we didn't know if we'd be able to film them. And just last night, we managed to see this. Now, this is an infrared camera, so it's actually pitch black there. And here is a young calf trying to suckle its mum. The mother will hide that calf away during the day and she'll only suckle it maybe 2 or 3 times, just keeping it completely hidden And you can see it's got a little bit of spotty camouflage on it there, just to keep it hidden away. Oh, it's a little bit unsteady on its pins there. Fantastic pictures. Wonderful to see the deer. By the way, this car here, this is where all our transmission is coming from. If something went wrong there, we'd be cut off. And there it is, all the aerials. And there's a little man in there making it all happen for us. OK, now, as well as those deer, this is a wonderful place at night for some magical birds. Now, let me just set this up for you. We think we've discovered something brand new here. There's a little tiny bird here. It's called a woodlark. And it says in all the books that at night, they'll go up and they'll sing for maybe 2 or 3 minutes. Well, we went out with our thermal camera and sound recordist, Gary, and we listened in. We found something completely different. Now, there's Gary Moore with his parabolic listening. And here it is. The woodlark. Now remember, this is completely dark. If you were out there, up here on the heathland, you'd just hear this sound. This bird is displaying, it's a male, and it's trying to show how strong and tough it is to any female that may be there in the dark. What we discovered was that it didn't sing for 2 or 3 minutes. That little bird sung for 2 hours, just showing how tough and how strong it was. Let's have a look what the adult looks like. There it is. John Paul Chartres has told us that. That's what it looks like in the daytime. Quite a nondescript little bird, but at night has that magical song. Now there's another bird up here, and this is a real speciality of the heathland up here. It's the nightjar. And here it is. This is with our thermal camera. You'd never see anything, of course, if you were standing here. Listen to the song. That's called churring. And that male is making the sound, showing off to the female here. And he can make 40 separate notes per second and change the pitch. She's picking up something about his song that makes her more or less, makes him more or less attractive to her. And here he comes. Coming in. And that was an attempted mating. And Gary, the sound recordist, thinks that the sound, that churring, changes tone as he comes in towards the mating. OK, now we've been following the story of the enormous white-tailed eagles up on the island of Mull. And in fact, the first time we saw them was on the very, very first spring watch, and that was 10 years ago. And in that programme, we ringed a little chick. After we'd rung it, the little chick just disappeared off the radar, and we thought it was gone. But Yolo Williams has some very good news.
I'm heading to a secret location on the west coast of Scotland to catch up with an old Springwatch favourite. Leading me there is Dave Sexton, RSPB Warden for Mull. After white-tailed eagles disappeared from the UK for 60 years last century, Dave has toiled for nearly 30 years to help these birds regain their rightful place here.
Dave, we're going in search of a very special bird, aren't we?
Very special bird indeed, yeah. He's known as Itchy, and he was the first chick that Springwatch featured back in 2005.
Itchy and his brother Scratchy were stars of the very first series of Springwatch. Scratchy has never been seen as an adult. Half of all fledged white-tailed eagles don't make it through the 4-year journey to becoming parents. But Itchy's story is different.
Itchy was wing tagged with a red wing tag with a letter I, and he fledged in July of 2005, and that was the last time I saw him.
So you haven't seen him for 10 years, more or less?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
We know he's been seen in the area in the last few weeks. We hope that this year he's got a chick, but we won't know that for sure until we get there and the guys go up the tree, and if they have got chicks, we'll ring them this year. I just want to see him, you know? He's a chick that I've held in my arms when we were tagging him in the first place, and now we're going to be doing it to his chick, so it's come full circle.
We land a safe distance from the nest, but Itchy and his partner are nowhere to be seen. We have to move fast to minimise disruption to the family's routine.
We're almost at the nest now, so we've got to be really, really quick from now on in.
In a cloud of midges, the team of licensed ringers and climbers set to work. We want to discover if Itchy has fathered any chicks. Sea eagles choose high vantage points for their massive nests, and this is no exception. A good 20 metres up a Scots pine. Then Dave spots an adult eagle through the trees.
I think that's the
female, yeah? I can't see a tag. Can you see one?
Oh, it's so hard to get a view.
Come on, Itchy, come on in.
Oh, they're both there.
Are they? Oh, there's... they are, wow.
There's it is, Itchy, the one that's coming in. I can see the tags.
Oh, I see the tags, wow.
The one, the second one flying. Yeah.
So that's Itchy?
That's Itchy.
Oh, wow.
Fantastic.
He's come back.
Oh, wonderful.
Wow.
Welcome back to Springwatch, Itchy. 10 years on.
And he's still got his tags.
He's still got his tags. Wow.
Look at him.
He looks in the trees then,
isn't he? He looks all grown up.
He does look all grown up, yeah, with his wonderful, resplendent white tail.
Oh, what a difference from scruffy looking and now grown up into this beautiful big eagle.
Well, well, well. 10 years on.
Isn't that amazing? I just can't believe.
Meanwhile, the nest climb continues. White-tailed eagle nests can be 2 metres across and 3 metres deep. Climber Justin finds a chick. Itchy has a daughter. Justin carefully places her in a bag and lowers it gently to the ground.
Phew. Wow, that's good.
That's excellent.
That's the chick down.
Yep, yep, safe and sound.
Oh, wow, look at that little beauty.
Hello.
So how old do you think this chick is, then, Dave?
15.6.
About 5 weeks. So the grey down is coming out and the new brown feathers are coming through. It's got about another 5 to 6 weeks to go before it's fully grown.
I can't get over the size of the talons. They're enormous.
Yeah. The feet develop first, if you like, so that's why it's old enough and big enough to ring now. So those feet won't grow a lot more. They'll get much more able to move them and grab prey. She can't really grab stuff much at the moment, but in another couple of weeks she'll be grabbing prey and starting to pull at it herself as well. So the parents will still be feeding, but at the moment she's totally dependent on Itchy and his mate.
So all this weighing and measuring, it's to sex it and see if it's in good health.
Yeah, this is our one and only chance to check that the chick is healthy, and this one is, so there's a pretty good chance that this chick will go on to take her first flight.
Because she's a beauty. She's an absolute beauty.
The chick ringed and weighed, Justin returns her to the nest, allowing this magnificent pair of birds to get back to their parenting duties. Itchy has played his part in fathering the next generation of Scottish-born sea eagles, meaning this incredible species is one step closer to a full UK recovery.
What a fabulous bird. Has to be one of my favourites. And it must have been amazing for Dave to catch up with Itchy after 10 years and see him fathering new chicks. Now, Yolo will be joining us tomorrow. He's heading down from the west coast of Scotland, and I'm sure he's going to be absolutely covered in midge bites. That was a complete midge fest.